all the distinguished guests who are gathered here this morning, especially fund managers in this, as I said, this meeting convened by Tri Serintan, growing Malaysia's economic prosperity with a new mindset. And my topic today is on making PR states the preferred place to live, work, invest and play, past, present and future. Actually, this is sort of a precursor, because I'm sure you're not interested in so much as the PR states as what we can do when we win Putrajaya and Malaysia next month. What does the future hold? Would it be like what the detractors have said, that if PR wins next month, Malaysia will go bankrupt? I think that the best rebuttal is not given by Pakatan Rakyat. The best rebuttal is given by former Deputy Prime Minister Tun Mahathir. Tun Mahathir says that PR is not going to drive investors away, and we are not going to make Malaysia bankrupt. It is only those who are racist that are bankrupt. And I think that is very pertinent, coming from a former Deputy Prime Minister. I'm sure that this is some of the sentiments that Barisan Nasional is trying to provoke. But let us look at facts and figures. I'm sure Selangor will give their presentation, and Dato' Sri Busam has very ably presented the achievements of Kelantan. Not what you read in the press, that Kelantan has made tremendous progress on HDI, on the Human Development Index, in terms of ensuring that people-centric policies benefit the people directly. And in many respects, I think that is an untold story. Perhaps many of us are surprised at the progress that Kelantan has made despite the limitations. Selangor, another success story, is probably best left to Menteri Besar, Dato' Khalid, for the afternoon session. I'll probably restrict myself to Penang. And I'm sure that Penang has been said to be the most happening city in Malaysia, whether for the right reasons or for the wrong reasons. But there's no doubt that when we first took over, some say accidentally took over, because nobody expected us to win. And you can see that the entire PRT was short of experience. When I say short of experience, I'm very, very kind, because really we had no experience. But I would like to stress that having no experience is not such a bad disadvantage after all, because we also have no experience in stealing money and in corruption. And that is usually the most critical success factor. Accountants, management talk about CSF. What is CSF, critical success factor? And I always say, when you run the government, one of the CSF, critical success factor, is you must have integrity in government and leadership. That's why we introduce CAT governance, CAT, competency, accountability and transparency. And when you talk about not only integrity, you must also instill competency so that you can have delivery. Nothing beats delivery. If you can have both delivery and integrity, I would say that you can see astonishing results. So for the last 5 years, despite what is said by my good friend, he claims that we have a deficit budget. I do not know whether he read the right reports. But the AG report is the ultimate, has the final say in the performance of any state government. And every year, we have recorded budget surpluses. Not one year have we been in deficit. And this is despite the fact that we increased development expenditure compared to the previous government by 55%. And this is also achieved. Despite the fact that we gave out 150 million ringgit in cash aid to Penang Knights, which was never given before. And this includes a very ambitious program to create Malaysian history, to be the first state in Malaysia to wipe out poverty. Poverty is defined as a household having an income of less than 763 ringgit a month. So in order to free Penang from poverty, you must ensure that every household has a minimum monthly household income of more than 763 ringgit. So how do we achieve wiping out poverty? I'm not talking about hardcore poverty. Hardcore poverty, we achieved that in 2009. Now we are talking about poverty in its most general and, as I said, a generic term. In order to achieve a poverty-free state, we must ensure that every family has above that amount, 763. So what we have done is that we guarantee a minimum household monthly income of 770 ringgit. If any family falls below that figure, the state government will top it up every month. So if it's 600, you top it up by 170 ringgit every month. We spend 20 million ringgit a year for this program. So in other words, we have done in 5 years what they could not ever do in 50 years. And of course, this has all been achieved by reducing our state government's debts. Penang, when we first took over, Penang had a debt of 630 million ringgit. We have reduced it by 95%. By 600 million, now our debt is 30 million ringgit. And I'm sure no other BN state can even come close. And of course, the final figure that I want to share with everyone of you is that when we first took over, our asset reserves was 800 million ringgit. Now, 800 million ringgit took them 50 years to accumulate. Now we've increased it to 1.2 billion ringgit, despite all the expenditures. So what it took, BN, 50 years to gather 800 million, we took only 5 years to take half the amount, 400 million. So I think this result speaks for itself. For those who say that Malaysia will go bankrupt, look at the performance of Penang, amongst other PR states, that we have recorded budget surpluses. The federal government, federal budget has been in deficit for the last 15 years. The last time a budget surplus was recorded was when Dato' Sri Anwar was the Deputy Prime Minister. So we want the federal budget to go back into surplus, we have to make him the Prime Minister. And our federal government's debt has increased from 266 billion ringgit in 2007 to 502 billion ringgit in 2012. That is more than 70% increase. And that doesn't include contingent liabilities. I don't want to use the term contingent liabilities when I speak in ceramahs because it's very hard to explain. But among bright minds here, you all know what are contingent liabilities. Contingent liabilities is estimated at around 130 billion ringgit. So you actually, the amount of exposure, that exposure at the national debt position is around 650 billion ringgit, way above the 55% of GDP that is fixed by law. So many respects, our debt situation is getting more and more serious. If Pakatan takes over, what we can guarantee is this: we will have a budget surplus, we will reduce our debt, and we will at the same time ensure that we will have a clean government. Of course, as Hussam and Dr. Sri Nizar has mentioned just now, how are you going to finance that? You say you're going to reduce petrol prices, give free education, abolish the North-South Highway toll. How are you going to afford to do that? Including, again, giving cash aid or cash handouts to the needy, wiping out poverty in 5 years for the entire country, and giving free Wi-Fi in public places to all the major population centers in Malaysia. How much would that cost? I asked Dr. Zul here, he's part of the panel together with Tony Kwa, who is and Rafizi, who is drafting the manifesto. He said it will cost us 46 million. How are you going to get the money? We do what we have done in Penang. What have we done in Penang? You save 25% of government procurement expenditure because you implement clean governance, open competitive tenders. And the amount of government procurement expenditure every year is 204 billion ringgit, including GICs. So at a 25% savings rate, that will work out to 51 billion ringgit. And the cost of all our programs come up to 46 billion ringgit. We still have 5 billion ringgit left to spend. 5 billion ringgit left to spend for the people of Malaysia. So I think we are on solid ground there. As far as costing is concerned, definitely Malaysia will not go bankrupt. Now, just to indicate that this is just not mere rhetoric, let me go on Penang. Penang's industrial transformation, as you know, from the 60s, 70s, 80s, 90s, and up to now, like the entire country, we grew based on several factors. Number one, foreign direct investment. The influx of foreign direct investment. Number two, government spending. Number three, exports and own trade. Now, is that sustainable? Is that sustainable? Is that sustainable for not only Malaysia and Penang? Can we be forever reliant on increasing FDIs, reliant on government expenditure, and also on export our way out of trouble? I think this is something that we've got to look at to formulate a different model. Because when you are so reliant on FDIs, especially government spending, you crowd out private domestic investment. And I think the crowding out effect has been explained and analyzed by many economists. I do not have to go through the literature here. And that is why we are stuck in the middle income trap, because we cannot grow out of our dependency on FDIs, on government spending, which is why we have increasing debt levels every year, and also on world trade. And if trade falls, we are deeply exposed. So you have to have a new formulae. And what is a new formulae? Human talent. We got to have the build human talent. We got to diversify our economy. We got to attract private domestic investment. And you don't do that, you must have the right people. You must have the right people doing the right jobs. You must have human talent. Unfortunately, Malaysia's greatest exports is not oil palm or oil, it is human talent. Many of you here may not be around. After a few years, you'll be going to other countries. I'm being very frank, isn't it? Look at what are the market rates that they offer you. And also, question of livability. That's also very crucial. Do you want to live in an environment that is not safe? It's not clean. That's not green, that's not healthy. I think these are very critical factors for the human talent that we want to attract. In Penang, we realize this, that we need not only to be the sweatshop of the manufacturing industry, we also need to be a smart shop of the services industry. We are looking at convergence at all levels, not just between the manufacturing sector and the services sector, but also at the public government sector. Our keyword is convergence. But at the present moment, what you see is not convergence. What you see at the federal government is pure silo mentality. You know what silo mentality is? Silo mentality like those in America. You have silos to store the wheat. Big, huge structures. But then they are the only one in 1,000 acres. Completely alone and separate. No coordination, no teamwork, no common goal and objective. Everyone doing their own thing. Nothing gets done. What we need is convergence. And that can only be done, that can only be facilitated when you have sufficient and abundant human talent to make that possible. Penang's GDP, at the moment, we are 50% manufacturing, 47% services. We intend to equalize it by 2020. We hope to have 50% manufacturing, almost the same 49-49, because you know, we are really the most industrialized state in Malaysia. 97% at the moment of Penang GDP is derived from manufacturing and services sector. Agriculture is only 2%, so in that respect, we are fully industrialized. And Penang is a very important test case that when we grow by relying not on natural resources. We don't have all the abundant minerals in Kelantan. We need to depend on brain power. We need to develop human talent. And the last 5 years, knowing the financial constraints that we had, you know, our budget when we first took over was around 400 million. Last year, we expanded it to around 1 billion ringgit. But even though we have doubled the state budget in the last 5 years, bear in mind that we are minuscule compared to the federal budget. The federal budget is 252 billion. The federal government controls 94% of revenues. All the state governments combined control a mere 6%. There's a need for decentralization because it doesn't make sense that local services are controlled not by local government but are controlled by the federal government. You know, one Australian told me during a town hall meeting that we organized in Penang that it was bizarre that the federal government is running bus services 1,000 miles away. I say it's not bizarre, it's grotesque. Because what would one bureaucrat in Putrajaya knows about bus stops and bus services when he has never been there? But that is what is happening in Malaysia. And this is one of our reforms that we will undertake when we win federal power, that we must carry out genuine decentralization to return power back to the people. In other words, think globally, but act locally. I think the time has come for that. For Penang, we have tried that. We have tried to return power back to people by implementing local government elections. Again, we were blocked by the federal government. They say this is unconstitutional. Letting the people vote for your councillors and mayors is unconstitutional. We do not agree with it. And that's why we got one of our most prominent constitutional lawyers in Malaysia, Tommy Thomas, to fight the federal government on this, that we have a right to institute and implement local government elections. Give a round of applause to Tommy Thomas. I'll go on the question of public transport later. I think it's something that is very key. But Over the last 5 years, we have seen that we have collected some international athletes, top 10 dynamic industrial cluster, top 31 business processing outsourcing, BPO locations. These are all international accreditations. They are not accredited by CIRIM or by the federal government. Voted the most 8 most livable city in Asia, and for the first time in Malaysian history, Kuala Lumpur is not the most livable city in Malaysia. That position has been taken by Penang in 2011 and 2012. UNESCO World Heritage Site in 2008, and of course, one of the, I would say, the most heritage-friendly city in Malaysia now. Have you been to Georgetown? If you haven't been there, you better go. Because many international visitors enjoy Georgetown. You should see why Georgetown has come alive. It is indeed. You know, here we talk about the past, the present, and the future to live, work, invest, and play. In Penang, we are also very concerned about the past, present, and future. Everything that the bond that binds us together is our Georgetown UNESCO World Heritage City. Why is it that I say that heritage is the bond that binds us together? Because if we want to understand the present, we must know our past. And only then can we confront the challenges of the future together. I think that is where heritage is the bond that can bind us together. Perhaps if you go back to Georgetown, or you go to Georgetown, you can see a little bit of your childhood, a little bit of the future. Because Georgetown is a place where all races, all religions, all faith can live together in harmony. Not necessarily all the time in perfect harmony, but in harmony. And despite what you read in the papers, there is no racial tension. Only those who want to kacau-kacau after being paid a few dollars here and there, voila. But generally, you go and see for yourself what is happening. We have also been a place for our anti-corruption efforts by Transparency International. AG reports have, the Auditor General reports have commended us as the best run government financially. And of course, in Penang, we don't talk about food, we are not a Penangite. We are passionate about our food, and that is why we have very wide waistlines. You know, Dato Sri Wan Aziza is very fortunate that she doesn't stay in Penang. That's why she's very sweet. Otherwise, I don't think she would, otherwise she'd be like me. Georgetown was voted as the top 8 island in the world that you must explore in 2011 by Yahoo Travel. Top 8 island in the world that you must explore before you die. So romantic. So you all better go so that you all can die happy. That was 2011. Now, recently last month, we were also voted as the 4th best place to retire in the world. The only city from Asia. And one of the reasons was that it was a very reasonable cost of living. But all this is possible because, as I said, I think the critical factor, there are a few critical factors. Number one, we have set up a vision. What is our vision? To build Penang to be an international and intelligent city. You all know what we mean by international. International means achieving international benchmarks. What do you mean by intelligent? When you talk about intelligence, it's just not individual intelligence. It's just not collective intelligence. It's also about digital intelligence. Digital intelligence means ensuring that we are connected digitally. Connected internet. Nowadays, without internet connectivity, I think we all die practically. If you have no internet, you feel as if that you are, you know, handicapped or something. You somehow so hooked to the internet. And we realize that. That's why we give free Wi-Fi in public places in Penang. If you don't believe it, go to Penang and test your food. See got free Wi-Fi. If we can do it in Penang, we can definitely do it throughout Malaysia. And of course, the other intelligence that we think that we need to build is, of course, institutional intelligence, where, as I mentioned just now, the need for convergence, private, public, and also the civil society at large. There's no point talking about attracting human talent. There's no point talking about attracting the best and brightest if the government is stupid. Who wants to live in a country where the government is stupid, isn't it? So if you want the best and brightest people to stay in your place, you better be a little bit clever. Then only people will stay. So you must have institutional intelligence. Not only do the right thing, but do it right. This is very different. Do the right thing is important, but you must also do it right. You do the right thing, but don't do it right, you also end up becoming wrong. So I think there must be institutional and intelligence. And also there must be sustainable intelligence. What do you mean by sustainable intelligence? When you talk about development nowadays, it's not development per se. It must be sustainable. It must be environmentally friendly. Because people want to live in an environment that is clean, green, safe, and healthy. And finally, you must have integrity, intelligence. You must have an honest government. Nothing is more important than having an honest government. Because you have an honest government in Kelantan, Nick Aziz has been the Menteri Besar for the last 23 years. Honest in peace. So we build, we train, we retain and attract human talent. You promote and reward diligence, expertise and entrepreneurship. Now what do you do when you talk about building human talent? We give money to schools. We give 12 million ringgit every year to all the various schools, whether Chinese, Tamil or religious schools. That's number one. Number two, we attract world-class universities. Recently, we managed to attract the Asian Women Leadership University, the only women's only university in South Asia, run by Smith College. Smith College is the number one women university in the United States. And we are very proud to have them come to Penang, a world-class university. But we are only not looking at the upper sphere. We are also thinking of creating a rising tide. Because we should not be too focused only on the gifted ones. You want to have real progress, you should have as wide a pool as possible. And that's why we are building learning centers to help those who are academically weak using unorthodox tuition methods, especially in maths and science. We are too weak in maths and science. We must focus on maths and science. So apart from Penang Learning Centers, we have set up a Penang Science Council. We do science fairs. We build Penang Tech Centers. We are focused on making Penang number one center of excellence in science and technology in Malaysia. Livability is very important. Clean, green, safe and healthy. Penang has been known as the Darul Sampah of Malaysia. But that was under the previous regime. Now it is no longer dirty. I think it is much cleaner. Yes or not?
Yes.
You have been there, you know. But yet, remember, it is the same group of cleaners who are doing the job. Why is it when they are doing the job under the previous government, Penang was dirty? But then when they are doing the job under this present government, Penang can be cleaner. Simple, huh? Last time, Penang dirty because last time government dirty, man. Now Penang is cleaner because the government is clean. So when you have a clean government, only then can you be fiscally clean. Green, I think we are number one in terms of green initiatives. Penang is the only state where you can't get free plastic bags. You go to Tesco or you go to any of the supermarkets, you either bring your own shopping bags or you have to pay for the plastic bags. We do it every day of the year, 365 days. This is part of our green initiatives. We ban polystyrene bags. We have no smoking zones. Some of my colleagues are very angry with me. By day, we are basic human rights. Because they want to smoke. Okay? And we are even willing to act against big business. Penang and Paya Chubong used to have the largest Lee rubber of the largest processing, rubber processing facility in Malaysia, run by Lee Rubber. Huge 25 acre site. It emitted, of course, a very foul smell. You are processing rubber. 25 years complained, tak jalan. In 4 years of us taking power, we closed down the rubber processing facility in Paya Chubut. Of course, Lee Rubber quite understand that. Because they also want to be green. And we are also appreciative of that effort. And finally, of course, I think in terms of recycling rate, the country has set a recycling rate of 20% by 2020. As of today, Penang has achieved a recycling rate of 24%. So we are not only 7 years ahead of schedule, we have even exceeded that target. Safety. Penang is number one in terms of safety. We are the most safe state in Malaysia with the largest drop of crime index. And of course, healthy. We want to be the first green state, also the first bicycle state. We are building 200 kilometers of bicycle lanes. And everybody is cycling in Penang, except me, of course, I got a crooked knee, so I got excuse. I think most important of all, you must have a good government that practice integrity, justice, and people-centric policies. When you talk about integrity, it's just not lip service. We practice integrity by declaring our assets certified by an international accounting firm. And if we can do it in Penang, we can do it when we win Putrajaya. An open tender system is sometimes magical. You know, when I built a green park, estimated cost 2.1 million. Open tender can reduce that to 1.1 million ringgit, saving nearly 50%. Imagine how much we can save at the national level. Human capital, I think I've gone through that just now, that whilst America may face a fiscal cliff, Malaysia faces a talent cliff. We must get the bright minds back to the country. Under PR, under PN, Barisan Nasional, they don't want bright minds. Because the brighter mind you are, the more threatened they are in their position. Whereas under PR, we want you back. Because you know, without you, we all will be in trouble. Encouraging entrepreneurship, SMEs is the backbone of industry. We realize that. We have done the three-pronged approach. We set up Smart Center that is a free advisory and consultancy service to all SMEs to do market matching, to give advice on research and innovation. We also set up an SME center where we give subsidized rental to new startups, but of course only for a certain period, 3 to 5 years. After that, if you leave to make way for the new ones. And we also have an SMI village where we allow these SMEs to grow by purchasing land. And all these efforts have shown some results. 4 out of the 6 National SME Innovation Awards in 2012 were won by Penang SMEs. So maybe some of you don't know that we are the number one SME state in Malaysia. Improving livability, I've gone through that. We also do some affordable housing despite some people saying we never build a single low-cost house. That's a lie. Since 2008, we have built 4,000. Private sector has built 9,000, altogether 13,000. We know that is not enough because nowadays so many people want to come to Penang, either to visit Penang or to stay in Penang. We understand that. After all, we are the most livable city or the most livable state in Malaysia. So we are taking a more aggressive approach for the next 5 years. From what the 4,000 that we have built, we want to build an additional 19,000 units. And we have allocated 500 million ringgit for this effort. And that, of course, took us 5 years to collect that amount of money. 500 million ringgit, the largest amount ever committed by a state government to build affordable housing. And affordable housing should not be boxes. They should be quality. they should be, I think, of decent standard, because every person has a right to live with dignity. And to ensure affordable housing in Malaysia is of good standard, we have chosen the best builder of public housing in the world. Where? HDB Singapore. They are building affordable housing. So those good quality affordable housing you see in Singapore in a few years' time, you will also see it in Penang. Of course, when we appointed HDB Singapore, we were all considered traitors, Singapore spies. That's why I was accused. But when Singapore invested in Iskandar, big hero. Arts and culture. Penang is now the arts and heritage capital of Malaysia. Our Georgetown Heritage Festival, one-month affair, is one of the most sought-after festival. We also have a literary festival. Tan Tuan Eng, the one who won the Man Asian Literary Prize, shortlisted for the Booker Prize, he comes regularly to our Georgetown Literary Festival. And I think we should meet Joe Siddig, the festival director of the Georgetown Heritage Festival. And perhaps in July, spend some time in Penang, I'm sure he would delight your artistic taste in all ethnic groups. And at the end of this month, we are having our World Music Festival in Penang. So if you want something that is earlier, come at the end of this month. Penang State, I think I've gone through that. All the initiatives that we have done, this one is in the news. This is what I mentioned about public transport. Now, we are committed to decongesting Penang. Our greatest problems we face when we took over Penang were what we described as three C's. First C, the problem of cleanliness. Second C, the problem of crime. Third C, the problem of traffic congestion. Three C's. We solve cleanliness, we solve crime. We still have to solve traffic congestion. Why? Not because we didn't try, we tried, but because the federal government refused to cooperate. Now, the sad fact in Malaysia is that the federal government has sole prerogative over public transport. Much as we want to move people and not move vehicles. If you don't have public transport, you can do nothing. And when we tried to cooperate with the federal government, we were rebuffed. They said they want to do the monorail. 2007 promise, until now, never do. Now they recycle that promise again. We feel that a tram system is more appropriate for Penang, because Penang used to have trams last time. Remember or not? You all sure don't remember, you're too young. But you are my age, you all remember when Penang used to have trams. We want to revive that, but if they don't want to build tram, never mind. Monorail also we take, Sapu dulu, belakang kirap. Because at least you have a public transport. But they refuse to deliver on their promise. Buses, only one we have is buses. And a miserable 200 buses in Penang. Even though we have 350, 150 buses are always in the repair shop, leaving 200 buses to the road. Why like that, I don't know. So we thought outside the box, give free bus services. We tried at the Georgetown Heritage Enclave. Very well received. Penang is the only city in the country that gives you free bus tours around Georgetown. Don't believe? Try it in Georgetown. After that, we extended it across the mainland. Across the bridge from Surabaya to bypass FIZ to Balai Pulau, to and fro. Yusmani was there, the MP for Balai Pulau, when we launched that program. Balai Pulau to bypass to Surabaya. You get free bus rides during peak hours across the bridge. And then we felt that this was very well received and popular. We wanted to extend it throughout the state. You know, when we did these two services, we paid nearly 3 million ringgit every year to the federal government. We paid free for the people, but state government paid. We decided to extend it further. Throughout Penang, give free bus rides during peak hours so that you can increase the modal share for public transport. And at the same time, reduce traffic congestion. We offered the federal government 10 million ringgit every year. But you know why it's answered. Give money, you also don't want to take. So we had no choice. They want to choke us to death. The federal government is intent on choking Penang traffic to death. In a way, sometimes we are a victim of our own success. Penang used to have around 60,000 vehicles a day. Now it is 80,000 vehicles crossing the Penang Bridge every day. Everybody wants to come to Penang. Average 80,000 every day now from 60,000 previously. During holiday period, even more, 110,000 vehicles cross the bridge. Thai Pusam, who doesn't want to come to Penang to see the largest Murugan temple outside India? It is in Penang. Chinese New Year, who doesn't want to see the Kek Lok Si? Muslim, who doesn't want to see the historic oldest temple in Jalan Masjid Capital Kling? People want to come to Penang. Of course, the food, very good also. So what are we going to do? When it is very clear their intent is to choke us to death, we refuse to be choked to death. We refuse to wait and die. So that is why we have decided to boldly undertake building alternative roads to try to decongest Penang traffic. What are the most congested areas? Tanjung Bunga to Batu Seringgi. You know that road has been used for the last 30 years. Still the same road. We have to build a new road. We refuse to build it on the coast because that will spoil the environment and the beachfront. We build it behind the hill. We have also to have alternative inner ring road around Georgetown so we don't use the same small roads. We also need a new road for the most densely populated area in Paya Chubut, Ai Tam. And the most important of all, or the most controversial of all, is of course our proposed tunnel. The undersea bay tunnel from Gurney Drive all the way to Butterworth. The first tunnel in Southeast Asia. How are we going to pay for it? Land swap. Land swap of 110 acres of prime land to this company. And as I said just now, estimated cost initially for four major highway projects, 8 billion ringgit. By open competitive tender reduced to 6.3 billion ringgit, given to two companies comprising also of two major Chinese construction companies, Beijing Urban Construction Group, the company that built the Bird Nest Stadium, the Olympic Stadium in 2008, and of course China Railway Construction Corporation that built most of the railroads in China, including the highest railroad to Tibet. So these are technically sound professional companies that can do the job in building that 7 kilometer undersea bay tunnel. And at the same time, I think this tunnel will also help to develop Seberang Perai Utara, the northern region of Penang. You know, we have two bridges. One, first bridge that connects Seberang Perai Tengah, the central, to the island. The second bridge that will be constructed soon on the south, but we have none in the north. I think it is not right to deny a third link to residents on the northern side of the mainland. And I think in terms of equity and balanced development, they should also have a third link. So that is why we have decided that we have to undertake this project. Of course, questions of environment. This is subject to DEIA reports. If it is not compatible or it is not complied with, the project will not proceed. And the consultant doing the DEIA is not appointed by the contractor, it is appointed by the state government. So this is also something new. In the past, you do not appoint the consultant, the company appoints. Now, we appoint. And at the same time, you know, when you talk about roads, it cannot be done overnight. The tunnel alone will take you at least 12 years. Completion date 2023 to 2025. Why will it take so long? Because you want to do all the proper due diligence, especially environmental due diligence. You want to make sure that it is sound, that it is safe, and of course it is environmentally friendly. That's why it's taken 10 to 12 years. But if it's going to take that long, you must start planning now. Because if you fail to plan, then you plan to fail. We have to start now, for the future. We do not want our future generation to turn up and become a traffic jam generation. So while we may not benefit, I think it is our duty as a responsible government to plan for the future so that they benefit. Sometimes it is the most difficult thing to do. But I believe that a good government must not only take care of your voters now, You must also take care of the voters and vote, because they will depend on you. And I can assure you that, that this is what the state government will do if we win power at the federal level. So, once again, for Penang, the Trinity of Choice has a destination of choice for tourists, location of choice for investors. We were top two for 2 years, 2010-2011. Last year, of course, Lama took over. Sometimes must give chance a bit. And then we are habitat of choice for residents. We want to be the habitat of choice for residents, and I think we have achieved that by being the most livable city. Now, what we have achieved in Penang, we still have a long way to go. But I think it gives you a glimpse of the promise possible nationally. If we can do that in Penang, for the whole country, when you have abundant natural resources, you don't need a Lynas rare earth plant to generate income for you, isn't it? You don't need that, close it down. You see, in Penang, we don't have a Lynas rare earth plant, but we are better off today than what we were 5 years before. And if we can do it in Penang, I think it's like more. Despite having practically no resources, sometimes they, you know, spinning something out from nothing based on one word, confidence. There is tremendous confidence and optimism amongst Penangites in the future. Why? Because they know that they determine their fate. And I think we should also give that right to all Malaysians. The time has come for the people to have right to dream. To dream dreams they never thought possible. Because the government fears them. Not the other way around. For the past 50 years, the people have been taught to fear the government. Why should the people fear the government? Why have the people done wrong? You don't steal land, you don't steal shares, you don't steal cows also. These people who steal land, steal shares, steal cows, being afraid, the people are afraid. No, that has to be, has to end. The time has come for us to have a government where we fear the people and not the people fear the government. I think only then can we achieve and realize our potential. Thank you very much.